Howdy from Fort Worth. Dixie and I are back again. We want to talk to you about social media, how it's changed our business completely, and really about two parts from it. One part is how social media has affected our business, and in terms of how I do it and how she does it, as well as the other part of social media we want to talk about is when we have social media blackouts. So first of all, do you want to talk about how social media has really changed the way you produce and shoot?
Absolutely. I think that social media, I mean, it's totally changed the game as far as content, because I feel like a lot of photographers or a lot of clients and brands are now just hiring photographers to shoot just solely for social media. And so really it's opened up our world as to the amount of different things that we can shoot for, because everyone needs content, especially for Instagram and Facebook and all of their ads and whatnot. So for as far as me as photography, I am serving as both a photographer and a director. Yep. So we're always shooting video and stills on almost every single job that we do, because most clients now, they not only want the still photos, they want GIFs or, you know, action shots, little slow movements.
Cinemagraphs.
Yeah. So every client that we have is asking for both, because video gets so many views on social media now, so with Instagram and whatnot. But as far as shooting content, I feel like also the clients are now needing all these different uses. So for instance, we shoot a lot for Rock and Roll Denim. They need basically every kind of aspect ratio that you can think of. So they need a super, you know, long horizontal for billboards. They need a super long vertical for their in-store stand-ups. Mm-hmm. They need square images. They need just your normal vertical, normal horizontal. So we're shooting so much content.
Or banners for the top of their website.
Yeah, the very top of the website. Mm-hmm. That's a very good point. And so just the amount of shots that we have to get now in every production has grown significantly with social media.
Right. And so you're basically shooting double your content. So you're
absolutely
lots of stills, mm-hmm. Lots of BTS, mm-hmm. and the actual principal photography for video for their
absolutely
5 to 10 second clips.
And a quick tip for that, you know, you always ask the client before that you're shooting for, what is the final usage of the images and where is the copy going to be going? Copy is like the text and graphics that they're going to be using. So for instance, if you're shooting like a magazine cover, you want to be sure and leave space on the top and on the sides in order for them to add in their copy and their text. And same with like billboards and stuff. They need to be able to put their big logo. So always communication is really key. You want to figure out what the final usage is before you go into shooting it. And a lot of times the final usage is everything. So you really have to cover your bases as far as, I always start wide and then I move in close. So that's kind of how we shoot. And then we always shoot stills first and then video. So we get the still shot and then we go into video. And that leads me to lighting. I think that's such a big part, because when you got to shoot stills and video, I'll let Eric talk about that. That's his jam.
Before we shot stills, almost everything was either natural light, mm-hmm. or it was with strobe.
Right.
And most of the time we shot strobe even if we're outside, mm-hmm. just to make sure we froze that image. Yeah. And plus it's easy to control for us. We do a lot of backlighting. But now that we're shooting a lot of video, we have to incorporate continuous light. So generally our lighting budget doubles or sometimes triples. Mm-hmm. Sometimes even more, but so we're lighting for both, but sometimes we'll just go ahead and light for video and then shoot stills with it, unless they want that still to go big, to become a big image, then we have to shoot strobe with it and then we'll use a BTS or freeze motion. Right. So my job has increased probably a lot because I have to add a couple more people to my crew. But now I have to add in video lighting, whether it's HMIs, whether it's Kinos, or whether it's, you know, LEDs, whatever it is, my lighting budget's just skyrocketed from there. So if you want to shoot video, great. Just keep that in mind. If you're inside the studio or if you're inside location, you're going to have to add light. So you're going to have to budget that in to your original estimate.
Absolutely.
So, my crew sizes mm-hmm. increased. My lighting is increased. Sometimes we have to get a rip truck just for that. But otherwise, my job is also, I have to keep the lighting consistent. So if we shoot the still gig, sometimes I'll have to put the light next to or behind it. And if I have to, I have to take the light away completely, the strobe completely away, and relight it with the video lights, and I have to account for that time. And video lights, compared to strobe, when you set up, you easily get by double the time. Just sometimes getting power to the video lights that are sometimes a 60 amp or 100 amp baits, you just have to plan that time in, or if you have to get a generator on site, you got to plan that too. So from terms of what I do, you just got to have the, I got to know what you want, and you got to know what the client wants.
Right.
So if I can, you know.
Communication.
Yeah, again. That's, I need knowing to communicate everything. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I need to actually know everything that your final project is,
yeah,
so I can actually light it properly.
I have a random question for you. This just popped in my head.
Wait, lots of those.
Yeah, so when I was shooting, so I shot for a TV show for 4 years, that swimwear show, mm-hmm, where it was like a docu-reality travel series. And I remember we had, it was very overcast in Canada where we were shooting. So we had an HMI on set, mm-hmm, and it was fine for the video, but I noticed in every still that I took, it was a different color balance because it wasn't flicker-free HMI.
Yeah, the balance wasn't flicker free.
Right. So you have to be sure. So what kind of HMI is it that you need to get in order for it to be flicker free? You just got to get.
Got to have a flicker free ballast.
Got it.
And you got to have a good globe in there, our newer one.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's.
It made
that's,
editing.
Yeah, a nightmare. keeps changing like that, that's a nightmare. And some of the LEDs these days also flicker. Mm-hmm. So just, it's your equipment. If you're going to use it, test it before the job starts,
yes.
And make sure stuff like that doesn't get in the way of your creativity.
Absolutely. I think that's a huge part.
Yeah.
And then let's talk about our Nikons. When we shoot for jobs like Nikon and shoot for or products or things that aren't released yet, social media, gosh, it can really
hurt us.
It can really hurt you. So, for instance,
and get us fired. I mean, there's so many things.
There's so many stories where people have leaked photos and things like that on social media before the product launch is announced, and that can really kill your career.
Yep.
So, in our sets, we always have what you call a social media blackout.
Blackout. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of, we have an NDA, which is a non-disclosure agreement, and generally that's from the production studio, or it's actually from the client. That just says you can't talk about the shoot, location, people on there, any celebrities that are on there, and it just can't, you can't talk about anything at any time until generally after the thing launches, and even sometimes after that, depending on the NDA, what you can talk about.
Absolutely.
We added a social media blackout clause with it, meaning when you come on set, we just take your phone. There are.
We put them in a basket. We don't confiscate.
Yeah, right.
Your
phone. Just for the day.
Everyone puts it in a basket,
right,
and then we put it away. And then at lunch, it comes back out when we're not shooting. We need to return calls and stuff like that.
Right. We have clients that insist on we cannot tag a location, mm-hmm, because it's so competitive. And some of the clients that we shoot, that they don't want anyone else finding out about this great location. I don't blame them. They've paid a lot of money for it. And when we show up, we wouldn't want anyone just copying that location by going there and shooting a different kind of, you know, material, but like the same type of material.
Yeah.
So the social media blackout basically says, if for some reason we allow you permission on set, like we want to have you shoot BTS.
Behind the scenes.
You're behind the scenes.
People know that.
And you can shoot it with maybe Dixie's camera or the photographer's camera or the director's camera or even the producer's camera. But it's generally not going to be your own camera. And that might be one of the only situations that will allow it. Then we'll release the BTS while they release the product. Because these guys might spend $50 million on a product, and they don't want it released any earlier than the exact date that they want it released. Because someone else will take it, and they can come out with it in a couple weeks and blow them out of the water. So their $50 million that they spent developing something is thrown down the trash. And that's on us if we allow someone to take pictures and get
so
into all
huge.
That.
So
yeah.
You want to always have we always have a powwow at the beginning of all of our productions, and we talk about the rules, the set etiquette for the day. Basically, your phones aren't allowed, or if it's a shoot, for instance, where it's not a product that's basically the product's already out and it's not a big deal and the client actually wants you. Sometimes they want you to share behind the scenes to get them excited. It
right.
really just depends, you know, on the client and who it is. Obviously, if it's personal work, you can share behind the scenes. But just kind of set the tone for the day and the set etiquette just to make sure everyone's on the same page and you don't get things released before they're supposed to. That's a really big part of
yeah.
it. And I've heard really a ton of horror stories as far as that goes. We've never had an issue there, but.
Right, and always ask people if you can tag them. Because a lot of people don't, like me. People do it all the time.
You're all stealth mode.
But I really want to be stealth mode. I want to, you know.
Be a little incognito.
Totally. Which, it's an advantage to me, because what happens is, as people hire me, I don't advertise anywhere. Mm-hmm. I barely have business cards. I have zero business cards.
Yeah.
When you find me, I tell you a certain rate. And the reason I tell you a really high rate is because that, like, hey, you found me. I'm going to give you everything I have. I don't have a big client list. I just have people that I specifically want to work with. And if I work with you, great. This is my rate. And this is what you get. You get the, you basically buying insurance. I'll make sure that you get what you want.
Yes,
but
and it will be amazing.
In terms of, you know, in terms of advertising, social media, I don't put out there like, hey, I'm a assistant, I'm a crew chief, whatever.
Yeah.
I keep it really secret. I guess another secret is, for me, it's worked. When
yeah.
I want to raise my rate, like I, you know, it's,
you don't have to announce it.
I don't
to
announce
world.
It to everyone.
Yeah.
And then when someone says, hey, why is your rate so high? He's like, look, man, I'm an insurance policy. I'll take care of this for you the first time.
And you do have your own insurance.
Right. You you're better.
That's a whole other video. We should talk about insurance.
Yeah, but that's this is part of this video too, because you, if you are doing any photography for commercial, mm-hmm. set up at minimum an LLC, mm-hmm. Because to protect yourself. Because on social media these days, we know people can get canceled. We know people can get banned so fast if they make a mistake, or if they think that
yeah.
person made a mistake, like that will end, pretty much end your career for at least, I mean, maybe forever, but for
yeah.
a long time. So get yourself protected, get an LLC at minimum mm-hmm. when you shoot commercial mm-hmm. clients.
And then you want to have insurance. That's
mm-hmm.
a big part of it.
Absolutely.
I love how we've gone to insurance for social media, but
yeah.
I use a really great insurance company, TCP Insurance.
Mm-hmm. Out of California.
And they're great because they are quick to give your COIs back to you if you need a location listed. What
yep.
is it called? A certificate of insurance.
Certificate of insurance, which mm-hmm. every rental house requires
mm-hmm.
and almost every location requires
right.
nowadays. It
yeah.
just specifically writes out that they are the insured ones on that specific piece of paper. So it protects them and it protects you.
Mm-hmm.
So
absolutely.
The yeah, TCP is like really one a really good one to go.
They will get back those COIs within
like minutes.
2 hours.
Yeah, I've had one in 5 minutes.
Really?
Yeah,
they're amazing.
Yeah,
because I used to have like a State Farm or something like that, and they would take like a week, and we just don't have that kind of time in the production
right.
world. It just doesn't work that way. So I guess that
cool.
leads me to our last point: is the importance when you're a photographer, maybe not so much when you're assistant, of branding yourself on social media, and. You know, it's such a big part of what we do now. You want to be sure and obviously have a social media page like Instagram. You need to have your Instagram, a Facebook, fan page. So everything branded. And basically what I use social media, so I'll post my final work on there. And then I'll also post really cool behind the scenes content and videos and how to's. Because people really like to get an idea of what goes on behind the
yeah.
scenes.
Yeah, how'd you do it? Yeah,
mm-hmm, exactly. And how you created the different shots and be sure and tag everyone involved, and then, you know, come up with hashtags that relate to the content that you're sharing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm thinking at the end of this video, we should share like a table of the best times to post on social media.
Yeah,
it's
for
always
sure.
kind of changing, but in our world, Instagram is sort of the biggest.
Right
thing
now, Instagram's
right now.
King.
Yeah. And clients, we've gotten clients from Instagram. Just I've had people reach out on this. Hey, I ran across your Instagram. I really want you to, you know, shoot this lookbook or campaign. So it's definitely been a really great tool to get the word out there about your brand.
Yep.
And I try to post about 3 times a week. A lot of people are super involved and they'll post every day at the same time. I am not that structured. I wish I was. I'm not a type A personality. I sort of tend to post it, you know, morning or 2 a.m. in the morning whenever I finish editing. But it is good to have some consistency there
mm-hmm.
for sure.
Right.
And then keeping it consistent in your feed.
Yeah, because I love seeing the picture, and I love seeing the behind the scenes. Even though I was there,
yeah.
I love, you know, it's just, I remember the energy that we had.
Mm-hmm.
And then seeing the video, maybe the few second video behind it too, it's
exactly.
really cool. I think it just tells the whole story then.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Absolutely. And I think also just the last thing I would say is on social media, interact with other people who are in your industry, interact with clients, you know, make comments. It really becomes like a cool full circle relationship as far as getting people involved in your brand. And it, you know, it just kind of keeps the ball rolling. So I think that basically sums it up. Do you have anything else to add?
I think that was it.
Cool.
Cool.
Right on. See you guys in the next video.
Take care.